My name is Sufia Koroma. I'm a senior economist at the FAO's Regional Office for Africa in Accra, Ghana. I will be moderating this session. The format
we are adopting will be, I will give a brief background on the opening, and then I will introduce the panelists, and we will ask three of each of the panelists a question to respond to, and then have an interactive debate. Distinguished participants, the importance of our topic for this panel event cannot be overemphasized, as most of the debates surrounding the WTO tend to miss and meeting centers on the nexus between trade and food security. The relationship between trade and food security is attracting increasing attention on both the trade and development agenda. The eradication of global hunger by 2030 is a key goal in the new post-2015 SDGs, and trade is one of the means for achieving this goal. Here in Africa, in June 2014, African heads of state and government made a series of very bold recommitments to the Malawi Declaration, and one of the key commitments is to eradicate hunger in the continent by 2025. Trade, and in particular intra-African trade, will also play a crucial role in the achievement of this commitment, as the target has been set for tripling this trade by 2025. The linkage between trade and food security have been subject to intense debate at the national and global levels, and have become central to many trade-related discussions and negotiations, as we can see here in Nairobi. A key challenge that pervades this discussion is the compatibility between measures intended to address national food security concerns on the one hand and the effects on the food security of trading partners on the other. To contribute to this dialogue, FAO has just released the State of Agricultural Commodity Market 2015, which aims to reduce the current polarization of views on the impact of agricultural trade on food security and how agricultural trade should be governed to ensure that increased trade openness can benefit countries. By providing evidence and clarity on a range of topics, the report seeks to contribute to a more informed debate on policy choices and identify the required improvement in the policy processes within which these choices are made. We had actually asked for some of these publications to be shipped, but due to logistics bottlenecks, they are not here, but we do have the briefs that are around. I can also acknowledge that some of the experts in this area who helped to shape this document are also present here. We have UNO from IFPRI, and we NATO, I don't know if I should say formally the World Bank, but these two are here. So, is to just introduce our panelists, and please come up as I call you. Our first panelist is Victoria Chomo. Victoria Chomo works for FAO, and her work in FAO involves WTO agreements relevant for fisheries and food products, and trade policies that facilitate adaptation to climate change by building resilience along the value chain. So you. The other panelist is Dr. Ratnaka Adikari, who is the current Executive Director of the Enhanced Integrated Framework Executive Secretariat at the WTO. Prior to this assignment, he was the Chief Executive Director of South Asia Watch on Trade, Economics, and Environment. He has also worked for the government of Nepal, UNDP, and has done considerable research in relevant areas of trade and the accompanying challenges like intellectual property rights, etc. Dr. Adihikari, please, you're welcome to the podium. Our final panelist is Gerald Masila, who is the Executive Director of the East African Grains Council. The East African Grains Council is a regional membership organization for grain value chain stakeholders, which include grain farmers, producers, traders, warehouse operators, handlers, and all along the value chain. The EACG
East African Grains Council facilitates efficient, structured, and profitable grain trade in the East Africa region by advocating for an enabling environment, training and capacity building, provisions of market information, and developing systems for structured trade. Jewel Masila, you are welcome. As we want this to be an interactive dialogue, we've asked some of our participants to present the questions to the panelists. So the first question will go to Victoria Chomo, and our distinguished participant has agreed to ask that question.
Good afternoon. My name is Emily. I'm an agronomist. The first question to you, Victoria, is we understand that openness to trade is generally agreed to be an important driver of economic growth and poverty reduction. But there are mixed views as to whether this positive relationship holds in the case of food security. So the question, in your view, how can greater openness to agricultural trade benefit food security status of developing countries? And what are some of these key threats to this greater openness that may need to be alleviated?
Thank you very much. Please bear with me. I got a cold on the airplane, so I'm losing my voice, but I'll try to answer the question. FAO's mandate, current mandate, is to support its members in their efforts to ensure that people have regular access to enough high-quality food and to lead active, healthy lives. In the past, I would say over the last 4 decades, people were focusing on agricultural production, agriculture, fisheries, and forestry, and improving production. But now the emphasis is on food security as well. It's not just enough to produce the food, but you also have to produce it sustainably and also make sure that people have access to the food. So FAO has identified 4 pillars of food security. One is availability. And we know that the world produces enough food for all. There's enough food on the planet now to feed the 7 billion people. The problem is access, a second pillar of food security, and that people need to have not only food available, but access to the food through having income to buy food or the resources to produce it domestically. The other 2 pillars of food security are stability and utilization. And we know from what we've seen since the financial crisis and the shocks to the commodity prices, having stability is also very important in the marketplace. So let me start by talking about global trade and in food products. What we've seen in our research is that this continues to expand rapidly, and countries are becoming more engaged as both importers and exporters of food as the world becomes more interconnected, and it's easier to ship food because of transportation improvements around the world. For example, fisheries especially has increased in the volume of trade. It's one of the most highly traded food commodities, and we're actually seeing exports growing faster than consumption. We have to note that the structure and the pattern of trade, though, however, differs depending on the commodity, as you know, and also the region or the country. So there's no generalization of what's happening to food trade. It has to be very specific. What we also notice is that there's changing patterns of food consumption around the world, mostly driven by rising incomes in developing countries, population growth, and urbanization. For example, we know that we are going to have 2 billion more people by 2050. So we have 9 billion people to feed. And again, if I can give an example from fisheries, we did a model called Fish to 2030, where we looked at production and utilization estimates out to 2030. And we found that we have a fish gap between capture fisheries and aquaculture, utilization and production. There's going to be a gap in 2030. And we need to find a way using technology or increased land and aquaculture or intensification to fill that gap. So we know we have challenges for sustainable production in the future. It's also been well documented that trade drives economic growth and poverty reduction. But what we need is the evidence on trade impacts and food security. And as Sufyan was saying, the most recent state of commodity markets focused on the links between trade and food security, trade policy and governance. We looked at 34 studies, and the evidence pointed out that we had mixed reviews. There were improvements in food security indicators due to trade openness. There was also deteriorations in food security, and so it's not really clear that one size fits all. What the study points out is that it's a very complex situation, and it's very region and country specific. Trade affects many of the economic and social variables that ultimately determine a population's food security and nutrition status, including growth, incomes, poverty levels, food prices, and the government revenues budget. In the long run, trade can also induce structural changes, changes in markets, infrastructure development, productivity, the composition of ag output, variety and quality of and safety of the food products that people eat based on international standards that are adopted, and the composition of diets. And the composition of diets we find can have positive and negative impacts from trade. As developing countries import more developed style lifestyles, processed foods, foods high in fat, we actually see an increase in malnutrition from that importation. As I mentioned, FAO has identified the four dimensions of food security: availability, access, utilization, and stability. And the state of commodity markets investigated the possible effects of trade and food security in the short run versus the medium to long run. And there's a table in the study, if you look at it, that separates the impacts of trade on food security short versus medium to long run, and also for the four different aspects of food security. What we found is the differences can depend on the status of the country, whether the country is a net food importer or a food exporter. The level of development of the agricultural sector is also very key, whether a country is an underdeveloped agricultural sector. Completely opening to trade may not be the best option for food security. And opening to trade in a more managed fashion might be a more positive result, as opposed to a more modernized economy or even a completely mature economy like the industrialized countries. Also, the existing policies, what's on the ground for trade policy, food security, meaning social safety nets, and the macroeconomic policies, for example, export taxes or subsidies, and exchange rate policies can also affect food security. And also, finally, what your trading partners are doing. The more you become exposed to international trade through exports or imports, what your partners are doing can have a big influence on you. So again, in fisheries, we found that when Russia imposed trade bans on its trading partners, the Norwegians in particular suffered their exports in salmon products until they could find other markets for those products. So just the one example, but the more you trade, the more you become exposed to these things. The relationship between the level of engagement of trade and food security is influenced also by the way your markets work, by the ability and willingness of producers to respond to incentives. So whether producers can actually respond to the international competitiveness or not would also have to do with the level of development of your agriculture sector. And also whether functioning markets like input markets or credit markets are available to them. Because if there are market failures, then opening your agriculture sector to international competition may not help your producers to increase efficiency if they don't have access to credit and inputs. So each of these factors need to be considered in formulating trade policy interventions on a case-by-case basis. And finally, no one size fits all.
Thank you very much. I think let's give a big... Maybe I can request that the organizers give you another cup of tea. Thank you very much. We would do all the questions and then come to the interactive dialogue so that we can have more time to do that. The next question goes to Gerald Masila, and it would explore the issue of the implication of long-term objectives for structural transformation for the private sector. And one of our participants would ask that question.
All right, thank you for the opportunity. So the agreement on agriculture provides the basis for articulating linkages between trade and food security in the multilateral trading system. However, like in, my name is Agnes and I'm from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Indonesia. In my country, agriculture and trade is handled by different ministry, and often those ministries have difficulties on sectoral coordination. My question is, in your experience, what are the main concerns to improve this sectoral coordination, and how can this be addressed? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you. That's a very good question, although expected. See, coordination is a problem everywhere. It's not only endemic to agriculture and trade. Actually, I participated in a conference on the 13th of December here in Nairobi, and they were discussing about trade, competition policy, foreign direct investment policy, and many other policy areas. And there also, the coordination problem exists. So let's first look at it this way, that you know, this is not definitely not endemic to trade or agriculture, but then this is happening. Our objective of our discussion is to highlight as to how, you know, through some of the examples as to how this coordination could be further improved. So that's probably, you know, what is necessary for us to understand. It is the silo mentality is the number one problem. When I say silo mentality, not only at the policy level, but also at the analytical level. Not only at the policy and analytical level, but also at the implementation level. And therefore, what the countries are doing at this point in time, and this is also happening at the global level, is that they are just protecting their own turf, and they are sort of talking to each other, you know, among themselves, rather than sort of talking to outside. They are more looking into the mirror rather than looking outside the window. And that's probably what is creating a problem. And we have to understand the fact that trade is a cross-cutting issue. Of course, all of us understand, but so is agriculture. So is agriculture. If we develop a policy, agriculture policy, without consulting with, let's say, Ministry of Infrastructure, which deals with irrigation, Science and Technology Ministry, which deals with research and development, Education Ministry, which deals with skill development, Industry Ministry, which deals with forward linkage and the backward linkages with agriculture, and Environment Ministry, which deals with climate change issues. And in many of the least developed countries where we work, we know that there's a parallel process going on at the country level to identify the challenges being faced on list by climate change, and the national adaptation process, so-called NAPA, is done by various countries, but what is their sort of linkage with agriculture and what is their linkage with trade is something that we have to think through. And this is where the silo mentality remains a major stumbling block. Second is the lack of interdisciplinary approach. You know, most of the research and analytical work that we do, as well as the policymaking process, they lack interdisciplinary approach. For example, when EIF, as an agency, we are doing analytical work called diagnostic trade integration studies at the country level to help them identify priorities, the trade-related challenges as well as priorities, right? And then we offer them solution as to based on the country determined priority as to what are the type of projects that we could potentially support. But if the trade analytical work is done without talking to or without involving agriculture expert or a political economist or a sociologist, then this would not become a credible study. So this is something that we are trying to promote at the EIF. And second, if an agriculture study is done without consulting the trade and industry experts and environmentalists, then it might not be a complete study. So there is a need to change this as well. The third is the confusion on who should lead the process. There's no mechanism that is globally accepted, and one size certainly does not fit all. Who should lead the process? Should it be the trade ministry that should lead the process, or should it be the agriculture ministry that should lead the process? Normally, in most of the least developed countries, agriculture ministries are more powerful because power comes with resources, and if they have the resources, they are more powerful, right? But agriculture ministry do not feel the need to involve the trade ministry in some of the policy-making processes and particularly implementation level, then the problem occurs. Similarly, when trade ministries are doing their own study and preparing their own policy without consulting agriculture ministry, not knowing who should lead the process can also be one of the reasons why this lack of coordination exists at the sectoral level. The fourth reason, in my opinion, is the confusion on resource sharing, how they should share the resources, where the resources should come from. Should it come from the government? Yes. And if it comes from the government, how it's going to be shared between the trade ministry and agriculture ministry? What would be their share, what would be the share of resources they will be in a position to spend? And on the basis of that, they can exercise power if they want. If it is coming from the private sector, then how it should come and who should do it? You know, there's a confusion there also. If it is coming in the form of what is known as aid for trade these days, you know, the support that is provided to build the trade capacity of LDCs, and this is part of what we do in most of the LDCs, you know, these resources, if they are coming for, let's say, an irrigation project or for building the seed sector, these are all, you know, related to trade, of course, aid for trade resources. Because they are ultimately aimed at helping the country to diversify their export and to enhance their exportability. But who should lead this process? Who should lead these projects? It's something that should be clear, but there is a lack of clarity on that as well. And there is a limited coordination at the global level as well, because there are different mechanisms that are taking place at the global level, and these are supposed to be the coordination mechanism, but they are not talking to each other, but things are improving a bit. For example, EIF as a mechanism which works to build the trade capacity of LDCs, and Comprehensive Agriculture, Africa Agriculture Development Program, CADDEP. You know, these two mechanisms were not talking to each other until recently. Now there's a bit of a dialogue that is emerging, and then EIF is now also participating in the global platform of rural development, and there also there's a potential for collaboration. This is being explored, but until recently this was not happening. And there is a realization that there is a potential for leveraging of resources, because one mechanism, one instrument is not going to be enough for the countries to take care of their entire needs, and there's a requirement to leverage additional resources. So in order to leverage additional resources, these mechanisms are now talking to each other. And finally, at the country level, donor coordination is also a serious problem. You know, some of the donors supporting projects at the country level, if they are supporting agriculture products or agriculture sector, they do not necessarily talk to the trade community. And they are supporting a trade competitiveness project, they do not necessarily talk to the agriculture commodity. And how many country assistant strategy prepared by donors contain a mechanism for a structured coordination at the sectoral level? Let's try to find this, and then, you know, we can have an informed discussion on that. But having said that, if I have one or two more minutes, I just want to give a ray of hope.
Yes, go ahead.
There are a few examples of EIF countries where the process is relatively better. I mean, not completely, not completely ideal or to the desired level, but they are relatively better. I'll give you three examples. Example number one of Nepal, where the DTIS, the Diagnostic Trade Integration Study, has been recently finalized. The recent update of the Diagnostic Trade Integration Studies, where four agriculture sectors have been identified for export potential, agriculture sector with export potential, for example, ginger, cardamom, then you have tea and medicinal and aromatic plants. Okay, so these projects are going to be implemented by Ministry of Agriculture, not by Ministry of Trade. And there is a precedence already there, because in the previous version of the Diagnostic Trade Integration Study, ginger was identified as one of the sectors with comparative advantage, and that ginger project is implemented by FAO with the support of EIF and STDF in Nepal. And this is actually, the implementation part is overseen by the Ministry of Agriculture, not by Ministry of Trade. So, and that's where the coordination role is important, and then this is one example. Another example, as I mentioned, the DTIS process, when it was being finalized, there was extensive consultation with various ministries, including the Ministry of Agriculture, and they have identified thematic committees which would be chaired by the Director General or the Joint Secretary level officials from the Ministry of Agriculture or Department of Agriculture, and they are going to be responsible for implementing the project. Third one is what is happening is that just a couple of months ago, Nepal unveiled its agriculture development strategy for 15 years, and that strategy has a major chapter dealing with trade. So there are trade officials and trade experts participated in the process, and trade officials also participated in the process, as a result of this consultation process, they have a document which is fairly robust, and then trade community also wants the document. So that's the kind of consultation that we could think of as one model. Another, Vanuatu. Vanuatu, the Director General of the Trade Department of Trade and Tourism and Industry is here, and then he would be in a position to elaborate. If you have a question, he is the person to ask, Mr. Marakan. But let me give you one example of what Vanuatu has done. They have what is known as National Trade Development Committee, and NTDC. And this committee comprises representatives not only from the Trade Ministry, Industry Ministry, but also from agriculture, tourism, and various other private sector representatives. And they meet almost every quarter, three times a year. And then this committee actually decides the priority. They shape the priority based on the analytical work and based on the consultation among the stakeholders as to what are the type of sectors that in which they should focus, right? And then they have identified agriculture as one of the sector of priority, and because of active coordination between the Trade Ministry and Agriculture Ministry, even the European Union's national indicative document has mentioned that due to the coordination between the joint work and coordination between these two ministries, it was possible for them to be involved and to support projects, on value chain projects on cocoa, coconut, and beef. Right. There's one more. Lesotho. I'll take 30 seconds.
Can you let us come back to that?
Oh yeah,
please.
Sure.
I mean, if you can.
Sure.
Thank you very much, and I think we should give you a round. We do also struggle with the same problems in FAO. I would ask the last question to Mr. Masili from the East Africa Grains Council. Jirel Masili, in the context of food security, attention is often focused on the use of trade policy to pursue short-term objectives, such as those addressing the impact of market shocks and the resulting changes in trade flows and prices that consumers and producers face. Positioning the debate in the perspective of long-term dynamics of structural transformation in growing economies would have significant implications for the development and use of trade policies compatible with improved food security. In the early stages of transformation, the development of the agricultural sector is a key determinant of successful transformation, but its role diminishes in later stages. Huge agriculture investment gaps in developing countries call for greater collaboration among public and private sector platforms to mobilize finance, skills, and know-how will be necessary to transform and add value to the agricultural production. In your view, is it possible to argue that a certain degree of support to agriculture in developing countries may help them in creating a more structured and competitive agricultural sector that is more attractive to private investment? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sufian, for that very loaded question, as I may say. But I'll attempt to respond to it, starting by agreeing that yes, when it comes to the use of trade policies to address short-term objectives, you always have the shocks that result as a result of, for example, if you have a shortage in food supply or a drought that will make a government want to import or put an export ban or such other sort of short-term policy interventions, they sort of bring in their shocks and so on and so forth. I do agree that yes, if we are going to have a longer-term view to developing agriculture and to getting us to move forward, we will have actually to shift the policy processes so that the policies support a more longer-term view and a longer-term solution, and in fact trying to attract a lot more investments in agriculture. I think one of the facts is that in developing countries, looking at the Eastern Africa region where we work, it is quite true that the investments in agriculture are extremely low, starting even with the government investments. I think there was a mention of CADEP where the Maputo Declaration and Malabo and all that, the governments committed and they said they will put 10% behind agriculture. And when the analysis is done, I think in this region, apart from Rwanda, there is no other country that has really made effort to meet those, to really invest in agriculture. And so for us in private sector, I think we also admit that the amount of financing and credit that goes to agriculture, last time I checked the statistics in the whole of Africa, it was less than 1%. The total commercial credit going into agriculture was less than 1%, and a lot of agricultural, in investments and all that are out of maybe personal savings or things of that nature. And so for us, our concern really around policy is supposed to address a number of issues. One, it's critical that we address market access at the regional level, looking at cross-border trade and looking at how to deal with trade, eliminating trade barriers. Secondly, policies that enhance productivity and make a country productive. And here we are talking about input, the input markets. How do you get your seeds, your fertilizers, and the rest of the inputs in a competitive, in a good price, and at the right time, and having systems that actually make this be timely. Thirdly, policies addressing post-harvest, because for us in grains and cereals, post-harvest is critical, because when you harvest your grains and your cereals, you will need to dry them properly, you need to store them properly, otherwise you've got the pests and the rest of the other fellows waiting to feast. Going up the value chain, policies around processing and value addition and really attracting investments in processing and value addition are important, and of course also a market access for the products that are being value added on. Next is policies around price and price discovery, and here looking at what should be the role of government in price setting and regulating prices or controlling prices is of great importance. And for private sector, stability and being able to predict forward is very important if you're going to do your projections, if you're going to make a big investment plan, either at production or value addition. You need to have stability, to know that if I project my 5-year, 10-year projections, I have a chance that within a margin of error that I would be able to get the results that I'm looking at. So we're seeing government to really focus a lot more on regulation and a lot more on food safety and creating a level playing ground so that private sector can work and really get the investments going in. And so borrowing from examples that we've been, from our experiences at the Eastern Africa Grain Council, at EAGC, we are working in 10 countries in the region, and we work within the membership structure. And our members are grain producers, both smallholder, medium, and large. We've got the aggregation agencies, handling and trading, fraternity, processors, distribution, and all the way to the consuming level. And what we've been doing to structure trade is two solutions that we've been promoting in the last 5-6 years. The first solution is promoting bringing the farmers together to be able to consolidate their produce, to aggregate their produce at the village level, and then pushing that product up to a certified warehouse where it will be preserved well, it will be taken care of, and you can preserve the quality and quality over time. And in that system, when a farmer comes and deposits their commodity, they get a receipt, and we have banks that we are working with that they can walk to a bank and not necessarily have to sell their produce soon after harvest, get a short-term credit, later on sell, and that process has been going on well. We've got over 4 or 5 banks we are working with. They've gotten credit in excess of 300 million, almost going to half a billion Kenya shillings, and with zero default. The second bit, and which is what we are promoting a lot more, is getting forward contracts, getting market requirements. What exactly does a market want, whether you are a producer, an exporter, or a processor? And here we've been facilitating business-to-business meetings where we bring buyers, and they come and say, this is what I require in the next 12 months, next 6 months. And we've come up with very interesting scenarios there where some processors, like soya processors, come and say they require 1,000 tons every month for the next 12 months, and they can commit to buy that, and they set a price. And when that happens, we're able to then transmit that order backwards to the farmers to produce, get it aggregated, and then a price is already set, it's already known, you've done your calculations, you know you got your margin, and then supplies then can take place. For some of the commodities, the lead time is very short, like for pulses, you're talking 90 days, 100 days, and a supply is made. And this is something that we're doing that then brings in investments, because we've seen even for some of the members we're working with, like in the brewing industry, the minute you get an order from the breweries to supply sorghum or millet, the day the rest of the other service providers know you have that order, they are at your door. What is it you want? They give you the credit and everything else you want, because they know they'll get it all paid back by the anchor buyer who is going to buy at the end of the day. And to facilitate all this, we've developed a trade platform. We are calling it the GSOCO online grain trading platform, which we launched a few months back, and we've also automated the whole process, where when a farmer delivers at the village aggregation center, they actually get an electronic printout and an SMS message into their phone, and all this aggregation we're able to see from our offices, and when they elect to sell, they just upload electronically again their requirements onto the trade platform. Then there's a matching engine, the transaction takes place, and the banks do the clearing. If they are given a credit, they recover their credit, and the transaction is done. And so through this, we are seeing a lot more investment, so many more people are coming up to put up warehouses, which we think are extremely important, but also to get more supplies for inputs, for seeds, because we are able to link them there as a way of bringing investments into agriculture, specifically around the grain sector. So that's just an example of the, some of the interventions we are doing at EAGC with support and in partnership with the various development partners, including the DFID through the Food Trade ESA, AGRA. We've also worked with USAID, and we're getting a lot of support from CEDA, which we are channeling into all these activities and delivering all the results. Thank you for now. We can engage later. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all. We've had a very diverse look at the issue of trade and food security, and I don't think I need to summarize the discussion. I want to open the floor for comments. I am wondering if some of the participants in the dialogue that led to this work would like to make comments, please just let me know if you have any comments to make. I would open the floor for questions and comments. Yes. Please identify yourself and
okay, thank you so much. My name is Jane Mudiga from the Kenya Women Media Owners Association. I would want to ask about the investment being done in media. Because, for example, in our association, you've got two TV stations, the one that broadcasts in agriculture to one region, and another one just specifically for farming, 24 hours broadcasting farming content. And we have seen these TV stations really being platforms where farmers are learning skills and innovations and improving their work. So how are we using these platforms? And are we putting, can we be able to put investment into it? We'd also want to see policies really looking into media and especially TV stations that really go to the grassroots within the policy framework.
Thank you very much. I think we can take a few more comments and then yes, the gentleman in front.
Thank you very much. I'm Desmond McNeil. I'm from the University of Oslo in Norway. I have a question for Olivia Chomo, but perhaps others also might want to respond. You said, and I think it's an important point, that trade can have adverse effects on nutrition in terms of promoting unhealthy diets. But and as we know now, in fact, more than 50% of diseases are actually non-communicable diseases, obesity, diabetes, and so on, related to this problem. But as we also know, recent trade and investment agreements make it difficult for countries to resist to have legislation or regulation which can constrain these sort of damaging trade. So two questions. In terms of FAO, to what extent do you see this aspect as part of food security? Do you define food security widely to include this problem? And secondly, do you have a policy response to the challenge of trade and investment agreements, which may actually be problematic in this respect? Thank you very much.
Thank you. I think that's a very interesting question.
Thank you very much for giving me the chance to make I want to just make a comment. My name is Ali Lee from Vanuatu in the South Pacific. I find this this very interesting because I think it applies to mostly LDCs, the relationship between trade and food security. I believe food security is very very closely related to trade because particularly in the small economies, we tend to want to export a lot of our commodities and not realizing that at the expense of the health of our population. If we're not too careful, of course, we will have malnutrition. And I think that the professor from the university a few minutes ago made a very valid point. My other comment is on coordination of activities and resources between the agriculture and Ministry of Trade. In Vanuatu, we found that we were not cooperating between the two ministries, and we have now, through the two ministries, interlinking, you know, sort of enhance our productivity and particularly our coordination of our resources. But I just want to come to the point the director, executive director of EIF mentioned on our EIF project. Through our TDS, we sort of identified the priorities of our development priorities, particularly in agriculture and the Ministry of Trade. After the IF, through the EIF, we set up our National Trade and Development Committee with the formulation of our trade policy framework, And through the trade policy framework, we established an institution, as mentioned earlier, of National Trade and Development Committee. This committee sort of prioritized most of our aid for trade funds through Vanuatu government. Most of our decisions of the committee goes through the Council of Ministers, and it's implemented by this National Trade and Development Committee. Quite effective. It involves a lot of stakeholders, Ministry of Finance, Ministry of Agriculture particularly, and donors, private sector, and NGOs. So we want to call it our trade parliament. So it's well respected, and it prioritizes all our aid for trade activities. We also have, in this committee, we have the donor facilitator that also facilitates and coordinates the donor communities. So we want to share with you this experience, and it's quite effective. And in fact, some of our priority projects through the EDF 11 is going through this committee, and we have targeted the rural development as our priority areas of development, because this will reach our population on the grassroots level to make sure that they get some rural development in this area. And it touches on certain commodities that we think it is very important for developing our grassroots people, our coconut, our beef, and our fruit and vegetables, particularly to support our tourism industry. So these three projects, we believe it will make a difference in the lives of our communities. But quite truly, for us vulnerable economies trying to do trade with the regional partners and the global community, we have to be careful with our policies, where our priorities are. If we are not too careful, we will be subject and vulnerable to as far as food security is concerned. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's very insightful, and we'll share those experiences. The gentleman in front. No, yeah, right there. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Hiramani. I'm from Nepal. I would like to go back to the question of investments. Agriculture benefits from two types of investment, the so-called investment in agriculture and investment for agriculture. Investment in agriculture is direct investment in activities related to agriculture, example, fertilizers, irrigation, etc. But investment for agriculture includes many other sectors that could help agriculture, for example, roads. It is relatively easy to determine the returns on investment in terms of the agriculture, investment in agriculture. But it's a difficult exercise to know what returns we are getting from agriculture for investment for agriculture. For example, one study concludes that in India, for example, the most favorable sector, non-agricultural sector, but to help agriculture is roads, and it is education in China. So different countries have different sectors that would contribute to agricultural investment. And there is need for research in what contributes most in terms of the investment for agriculture. But we know that overall, resources for R&D, research and development in agriculture, are declining. So in this context, whether you had any reflections on how could we strengthen the efforts to determine the returns of investment in sectors beyond agriculture. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I think before we take more questions, let us get some responses and comments. I'll go to you because I think there was something more specific.
Thank you. I'll try. The question by Desmond from Norway is very important for the FAO. We are very concerned about malnutrition and changing in diets, partly due to trade and also just due to income rising and changing in tastes and preferences. You can have countries, developing countries, where you have stunted children from lack of adequate diet. At the same time, you have people with obesity. So these are equal concerns. We have evidence from Africa, though, where countries that are exporting very high-value processed fillets to the European Union or the United States
And there's some concern that they're sending out this high-value fish, which is high in protein and micronutrients, going to the developed world. And I have to say that more than 50% of exports in fisheries products come from developing countries going to developed countries. But at the same time, the evidence shows those same countries are importing low-value fish, small fish that are considered trash fish, but they actually have more micronutrients and more value nutritionally than the fillets. So they're actually bringing in lower cost fish that have higher nutrients. I have colleagues who are actually working now on finding ways to grind up the waste of these filleting processes, the bones and the fish meal, into a product that can be incorporated into school lunch programs. And they're doing that in Latin America and Africa right now. So there are many aspects to food security from trade, some of them positive, some of them negative. And you have to look at an individual case in order to know.
Thank you very much. I think let me just add a few points to that. I think the director touched on on a key point there in the detach between trade and investment agreements and agriculture. In most countries, it is done in the ministries of trade or ministries of finance, and agriculture is seldom contacted. But another dimension that we are finding out in FAO is that when we look at some of the food composition tables of some of the African countries, you find that they only cover about 40-45% of the food that are actually consumed. So most of the nutrient-rich food at the national level are ignored. They are not counted. So we are concerned about our measures of food security and malnutrition. So now we have some initiative to start to expand, because these food composition tables are 40, 50 years old. I mean, we need now to expand those composition tables, because that is also, you have a lot of nutritious food at the national level that are not reflected, and we are not collecting enough information on them. I just wanted to add also the point that in the area of investment, because of this problem of tough at the national level, I mean, we even try to look at the principles of responsible agro-investment, which we are doing with a consortium of other agencies, I mean, the bank, UNCTAD, ourselves, and IFAD. I mean, to try to ensure that those investments respond to the food security challenges of some of these countries. So I will stop here. Director, you want to?
This is nothing in particular, but you know, talking about this investment, I think you know this is one of the aspects that we have to look at very seriously. A declining investment in agriculture or for agriculture, whatever you call it, but you know, this is not a good sign, because the public investment was the means to secure food security. In the past, I mean, this is how we secured food security in the past. Although the private investment is coming and it should be encouraged by all means, some of the public goods that are required to be, you know, financed only through the public investment will either have to be financed by the government themselves or through development financing. And there is this you know, aspect that has to be understood clearly. Private investment, of course, will be there in sectors where profitability is fairly high and there's a very, very short sort of gestation period. Then you can attract private investment as well. And there is a possibility of complementing private investment with public investment on certain sectors. For example, even if research and development is mostly in the public domain and it is a sector which used to be financed through public money, now there's a possibility of having a public-private partnership approach for research and development, where the private sector contributes resources, and the government sector also contributes resources, and certain skills and expertise. So there is a possibility that there, and which should be explored, I guess, in the area of research and development, for example. So that's, I think, quite important. Talking about briefly the, let me go to the basic level. You know, I mean, since this is a very stimulating debate that we are having on this, When we are talking about trade and food security, we should not only be looking at the direct impact of trade on food security, or direct linkage with production process itself. You know, we at EIF do it slightly differently. While we support directly food crop, which supports the food security interest of some of the least developed countries, such as, let's say, such as rice in Cambodia and vegetables in Lesotho. These are the products that we support that directly contributes to the food security. But at the same time, we also support various other projects, you know, cash crops. Production of cash crop, enhancing productivity of cash crop, and creating the standard institutions, bodies, and importing equipments and training the experts in order to help them not only produce efficiently, but also to export, right? And that would eventually result in increased income for family, which would be spent on procuring food products. So that's something that we have to look at. But this problem that the professor from Norway has raised is a serious issue, and I don't have any answer to it. But you know, this is the only possibility that I could possibly think of is to have a safeguard mechanism in place whereby the health and environmental safeguards can be invoked in order to ensure that, you know, these harmful products, particularly food products, are not imported into the country. So that's possibly one of the options, and feasibility of this option is probably, you know, something that is open for debate and discussion.
Yes, thank you. Let me also comment. First, I think to the media question, it hasn't been addressed, so I would like to address that one and say that there is opportunity for partnerships, lots and lots of opportunity for partnerships between the media owners and the rest of the other stakeholders who are also taking in quite a lot of, doing a lot of things and interventions. And so I would encourage you to like reach out to as many of them, especially those that can provide content that can then go into your media, into your various media channel, and partnerships can be crafted around that. Specifically to do a lot more knowledge and education, even on the issue of nutrition that is now being discussed. And we know in this region, over the years, there's been a major shift in tastes and preferences, where consumption of certain foods like rice or wheat has increased tremendously. Just to give you some example, in 2004, we have data that this country, Kenya, imported about 600,000 metric tons of wheat. Last year, 2014, the figure was reported as 1.8 million in a 10-year period. You can see that growth. This year, we are estimating way above 2 million metric tons. So, you know, as some of the things that have happened, and in our membership, we are trying to say, how do we promote more consumption of millet, cassava, and several other sorghum, you know, nutritional, good traditional foods that should even go into industry through blending. And we're estimating the other day that if you could have a 5% blend of say millet or sorghum into wheat products, the resultant demand is so big that it would be a very big demand for the farmer. So I'm just suggesting that is indeed something that can be done. Secondly, from the investment perspective, I think it is important to look at the value chain and to look at the multipliers that can be created and see how we can align activities to later sort of reap a benefit somewhere above somewhere up in the value chain. And one example I can give is the livestock sector, for example, which dairy, beef, poultry production really depends a lot on cereals for feeds, and feeds constitute over 80% of the cost of producing any of these commodities. So if you can reduce the cost of these feeds and cereals going into producing beef and poultry and dairy and all that, then you bring down the price of these other products, you would be increasing food security and improving nutrition significantly. And this can be done. One of the engagements we have had with the governments in the region is to allow, for example, yellow maize to come specifically for animal feeds. At the moment, if you are going to import yellow maize here, you have to pay duty, 50% duty. And it's quite expensive, so you'll not be able to do it. And there are options. What we are saying is that if we really can sit together to look at what we can do, I think it's possible. Finally, a big issue is the question of land use policy, especially for us in the developing world. We have a problem. In Kenya, for example, all the prime land is now being converted into this city and that city and that city. Instead of having such kind of developments and constructions and estates going into less productive regions, and they are there. But we now, between here where you are in Nairobi and say the next town, Thika, was a big producing region for coffee years back. We have predicted now that in the next few years, there won't be a bush of coffee between here and Thika, and yet that is something that would be a big honor. And so there are issues around land use, and not only in Kenya, in most of the regions we are working in the region, it's a problem. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have Eugenio has requested for the mic.
Thank you. Eugenio Diaz Bonilla from IFPRI. I was part of the advisory group to the SOCO publication. Suggest also to, if people are interested, look at the background papers. There are several background papers for that topic. And I'd like to have expand a little bit on this issue, trade may be good or bad. In fact, what we discussed is that you have different definitions of trade, you have different definitions of food security, and there are multiple combinations of, for instance, trade as a physical exchange. Then you cannot say trade is blame because supply and demand were, you know, linked to more consumption of junk food. It basically is a supply and demand issue, and you need to regulate, if you want, the labeling or the tax on sugar or whatever. It's not trade, it's just a vehicle to link supply and demand. Then there's the issue of trade policies, as border measures. Then the issue of trade, WTO trade policies, which is different from border measures. And what we look at, sorry, is that different policies may have different impacts depending also on other policies. What is your exchange rate? What is monetary policy and so on? So you have a lot of combinations on trade, which in fact are more than trade, just one word. There are a lot of different instruments, A. And B, then you have a lot of different dimensions of food security, as Victoria mentioned. So for instance, protection may help you increase supply because the price is higher, so then you supply more products, but then you are affecting access because the price is higher, then consumers will consume less. So basically, because you have different trade policies and you have different dimensions of food security, and these combinations can be against the rest of the policy package, and it's not the same if you are doing trade liberalizations with a overvalued or undervalued exchange rate, completely different results. Then the basic message was know your country, know your structure, know your policies, and do a specific type of analysis, because it's not possible to say trade is good or bad. You know, do the specific analysis. Usually it's good, trade is good in the sense that it's putting together supply and demand, and to the extent that it's freedom of people wanting to consume something and people to produce something, in principle, should be good. But then whatever impact, particularly in the short term compared to the long term, it will very much depend on what type of policy you are talking, what is the structure of your country, what is the rest of the policies, and what dimension of food security you are looking at.
Thank you very much for that clarity. Yes, we'll take next series of questions.
I'm Benson Kadhuri from East African Trade Review. Mine is specifically to Mr. Masira. Development of markets. I don't know what you are doing about markets, not even regional, even national markets. Talk of a big capital like Nairobi with excess of 4 million people, but it doesn't have an operational market for anything. Now, if that basic thing, I believe that is where you begin, and it makes, you know, trade better. we have, you know, we have traders coming from Tanzania, bringing commodities here, but they have nowhere to sell. How do you move from there, or what are you doing now in that council other than looking at what the big players are doing out there, mills and processors? We are talking about markets.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments or questions? Yes.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. I'm Kasim Gombe from the International Growth Center. Looking at the picture of women, the role women play in agriculture, I'll ask a question, I think, to Gerard, and maybe I'll get a big picture from Victoria. So women play a big part in agricultural processes, especially in production, but when it comes to trade, they are not that much proactive. And I think mainly it's because of capacity constraints. So as EAGC, are there any local strategies to target women? For example, you talked about forward contracts. So do you try to give some priority to female farmers on that? And I would like to hear, get a big picture maybe from Victoria about the perspective of the FAO on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll take the last question from the lady.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Martha Mugambi from the Kenya National Chamber of Commerce and Industry. I have a very big concern with regard to women and men farming and the supermarkets, the chains. We are seeing our farmers day and night growing everything in this country. If you travel across the regions, you will find our products across the region. Our farmers' lives are not improving. Question is, as much as we are talking about the policy, who is going to ensure that the pricing of our commodities are balancing? I went to Cairo through the COMESA region. I went to Botswana, South Africa. You find our mangoes manufactured and the juices coming back to Kenya in new rebranded packets. Question is, this farmer, I grow hibiscus myself. That is a calcade, chamomile, and lemongrass. I get almost nothing. When I go to the supermarket, after the hibiscus have been processed by a factory, I'm buying it as in tea leaves. You can imagine the price. Question is, from this symposium, trade symposium, what can we really do as a resolution to ensure that things are changing? As we are talking now, where I come from, Meru, the roads are impassable. You cannot get there to get the dormers to the supermarkets, the environment. I would like to speak on behalf of these people as a chair of Women in Business. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think I would ask the panelists to respond in 1 minute each, please.
Thank you, Chairman Sufian. I'll respond to the specific question. I think the first one was about women participation and very specific, what are we doing at TAGC? And a very good question. For us at TAGC, we have a very special focus on women and also the youth, but specifically on women. Part of the farmer groups that we are working with and we are supporting, we are training, we have special programs for women-led and women-owned warehouses and also women farmer groups, where we are able to address them at that level and link them to the markets at that level. And we do have quite a number that we've been able to link directly to millers where when they aggregate about 1,000 bags or so, a miller actually sends a trailer to them and picks the grain right from the aggregation level straight into their mill without any person or any middleman coming in between. And we've seen them grow over the 3-4 years where they've even constructed warehouses. They've been able to get a credit from banks because of getting organized. In the warehouse certification program, we also have special support to women-owned warehouses where we're giving them further support than all the others in terms of even equipping them and more of the capacity building. And then also specific to women, we have a special program where we're working with the International Trade Center with India, supporting India's trade with Africa, a program called CETA, where this region has been selected to supply pulses for export into India. And as you know, pulses really, when you do the profiling, they are very much a women crop. It's produced by women. And so the farmer groups that have been profiled to do the production for this particular market are mainly women. And we are going out and reaching out to the women to get them as involved as possible. So we do have that lens on the women. The question on markets, I when you think about the traditional market as a place where I come with my 3-4 bags or my 10 bags and put them at the corner and maybe sell half a bag today, wait tomorrow, sell another bag, I do agree looking at it from the whole range of agricultural commodities, cereals and non-cereals, is an issue in the region in that there isn't sufficient infrastructure for markets. A city like this here in Nairobi, the main market here called Wakulima, was put up before independence, I think, to the best of my knowledge, and is still quite insufficient in many ways. And most of the rural places, even peri-urban places, you will go to buy your vegetables, you wouldn't be surprised to buy vegetables from literally from the ground, and you know. And so it's an issue for us at in the cereal sector. I mentioned the GSOCO grain trading platform, which is the market we are developing for the future. And this market is not you are carrying the bag and doing the physical exchange, but is having the grain in certified warehouses, then having warehouse receipts as the certification of that commodity, then trading the receipt, not trading the physical grain. And so when you buy the receipt, all what you'll be doing then is to take delivery later on, whether it's for a portion meal or a main whatever other kind of consumption. So that's what we are developing into the future, and it will be able to work because all these warehouses will be networked and you can be able to just get delivery through that.
Thank you, Jurian.
Thank you.
Mr. Director.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. I'll try to respond to combine my response to address two questions that were raised here. One of the things, you know, the return of agriculture sector to the farmers, to the community, and this is something that is very important for us to understand. And where what we have seen is the example of farmers just, you know, selling the raw material basically in the raw form to for export to other traders, right? What can possibly be done, and this is not a theoretical possibility, I'll explain with the help of an example. What could possibly be done is that rather than exporting them in raw form, we should work towards adding value to the product, right? And how we add value, if we don't have any public investment and the private sector is not interested, then what we do is a third option, that is to form the cooperatives of people who are like-minded, who are interested in promoting and protecting the interest of the community, right? And then with the help of that, you set up a cooperative, and then access to finance is a problem in many countries, and technology as well. But if these problems could be alleviated partially through some form of public support or the support from development partners, then it would be possible to add value and then be able to export so that maximum value is retained by the community. Just one example. In Mali, what we had done initially is to support the production of mango, and the farmers were producing mango at a quantity, and they were unable to export because of high international standards they would never be able to comply with. And because of that, there was a glut of mango, and it was just rotting there in their warehouses and in farms. So what we then did to the, with the help of the government of Netherlands is to create a women's cooperative where they the equipment and standard related facilities were provided by the Netherlands government, and we provided them the tech, the training and capacity building support in order to enable them to process the mangoes into mango jams and dried mangoes. And now they are exporting, this women cooperative, they are exporting mango jams and dried mango to some of the European countries, and particularly mango jams fulfills the European Union's requirement and is able to, is being exported to countries such as France and Luxembourg. So this is a, this is an example which might be inspiring and worth emulating for other communities as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, our Victoria.
Yeah, just briefly, my colleagues have already addressed the issue of the role of women in agriculture. Of course, FAO is very much concerned about employment of women and youth in agriculture. And as was mentioned, we've done a lot of work on helping women build cooperatives and networks, and also having access to resources in a lot of countries, like land tenure issues in a lot of countries, and in access to credit. We also agree that developing the value chain is very important for employing women, either identifying new markets, regional markets, or processing and value added. These are excellent ways to employ women. And just one more minute, I want to go back and revisit the question about the nutrition, because I think, to clear, 30 seconds, okay. As members of the WTO agreements, and that includes the sanitary and phytosanitary agreement, one cannot block food products unless they threaten animal, human, or plant health. So just on the basis of not wanting people to eat sugar, that's not legitimate for WTO members. But national governments have responsibility to educate their populations in nutritious diets. And they can do that through schools, through media. And it's very important for governments, because that would, down the future, reduce the health bill of these problems that come from unnutritious diets.
Thank you all. Thank you very much. Can we give a round of applause to our panelists? And thank you all for coming. We hope this debate will continue. Bye-bye.